Broadcast messages are a new feature in GameMaker Studio 2.3 that let both your sprites and sequences interact with your objects. They're easy to use, flexible, and powerful, and I'm going to explain how they work, use them in a simple project, and talk about when you should use them. Broadcast messages, as you might guess, are messages that are broadcasted by sprites or sequences, and then they can be picked up by objects, and those messages will contain some specific information. You can create these messages in the sprite editor for sprites or the sequence editor for sequences, and they will trigger either on that frame for a sprite or at that point for a sequence. When they are triggered, they sort of go off into the ether. Behind the scenes, of course, GameMaker is tracking them in some way, but conceptually, you can imagine that they are just being fired off into the air. You can tell any object then to listen for those messages, and if they hear them, do something. In that way, broadcast messages can be thought of like a signal fire. A sprite or a sequence lights it, and if anyone is looking for it, they'll see it. But if no one is looking for it, then it won't matter. Nothing will happen. Objects, or more accurately, instances of objects, look for these signal fires by using the broadcast event found in the other events section. And these messages contain three pieces of data, all held by the variable event data, which we'll talk about more when we switch over to GameMaker. First, all messages contain the event type, which is the string sequence event or sprite event, so you can tell whether or not the message comes from a sequence or a sprite. Second, the message contains the message. This is the string that you specify when you create the broadcast message in the editor. Finally, the message data contains the element ID, which we'll talk about more, again, once we switch over to GameMaker. So now let's actually switch over to GameMaker and use them. Let's start by looking at our finished project. We have a little island here with two houses. And if we click on the door of a house, someone comes out. If we click again, they go back inside. And we can do this for either house. And this is happening because the door object, which has the door sprite attached to it, is sending out a broadcast message when it is opened. And the person object is picking that message up. But before we get to the code, let's do a brief project overview. I've downloaded a collection of free-to-use sprites. There will be links below and in the license file included with this project. The project, by the way, is also available for free on GitHub, and there's a link to that down below as well. There's one room. It has a background, several tile layers, and one layer for instances. On this layer, we have four objects, two doors and two people. Both doors are instances of the same object, and the two people are children of the same parent. The only difference between them is their sprite. All of the code is in the parent object, but they do have some object variables set in the room editor, and we'll come back to see that in a moment. For this demo, I am going to be using broadcast messages in sprites. If you would like to see an example of broadcast messages being used in sequences, check out the link in the top right to a video by Mathrew. But now let's look at a sprite. Our sprite contains one broadcast message here at the start of frame 3. Its message is door opened. To show the process of creating it, I'm going to delete this message and recreate it. And that's all we need to do to set up a message. Now, this message will go out whenever the sprite hits this frame, which it can do either as part of an instance or by being placed on the asset layer in the room editor. We'll be using it as a sprite assigned to an instance, specifically to an instance of the door object. So let's look at that door object. Our code is extremely simple. In the create event, we set image speed to 0. In the left pressed event, we set it to 1. And in the animation end event, we set it back to 0. That's it. Most importantly, no reference to any other object is in this code. There is one other important thing to note. I am using object variables. The door has an object variable named door name, which is a string. We'll set this in the room editor in just a moment. Our person object is equally simple. In the create event, we set visible to false. For our simple project, this is enough. The object can always exist and we'll just toggle whether or not it is visible, but you could set it up so that some other object is observing the door and creating and destroying or activating and deactivating this person instead. Just as with the door, I am using an object variable for our person as well. It is a variable named myDoor and also takes a string. And again, we will set this up in the room editor in just a moment. But let's first look at our broadcast message event. The first thing to note is that we have the variable event data. This is a built-in variable provided by GameMaker Studio in this event, and it is a map, which means that we access the data it contains using a map accessor. We'll see exactly what this means in just a moment. So first, we check the message to see if it's the door's message. This is technically unnecessary in our project as it is the only message we're sending out, but generally you'll need to determine which message was received, and this is how you do it. We then check the element ID with the function layer instance getInstance. The element ID is a reference to a specific ID of an element on a layer. That element could be a sprite, a sequence, or an instance. In this case, it can only be an instance ID, and we know also that that instance has to exist. But if your project is different, maybe it has many broadcast messages, some of which could be coming from sequences or sprites, or it is possible that the instance is destroyed after sending out the broadcast message, you would want some additional checks here, such as element type and instance exists. But again, for our project, we know it is an instance and that it has to exist. We then check whether or not the message came from the right door by checking the door's name and comparing that with the name of the person's door to see if they match. So now let's actually set these variables in the room editor. To set an object variable, you click on the object, click the variables, and then set it to the appropriate value. We're going to set this to red door, this to blue door, and then give each person the correct corresponding name. And this really is 100% of the code. And we've even already seen how the project works, but I am going to run it one more time with two changes. First, I'm going to comment out this code and use this version instead. Both versions of the code do the exact same thing, but this one uses more steps. Normally, you wouldn't want that. But the other thing I'm going to do is put a breakpoint here so we can step through this in the debugger. And these additional steps will give us more to inspect as we're stepping through the code, which will allow us to see exactly what is happening. So here's our project running in the debugger. And if I click a door, we can see that our breakpoint has triggered and we can stop and inspect the data. First, we can save event data into a variable so that we can inspect it. It is a map, so we want to view it as a map. And here we can see the three different types of data that event data contains. The event type, which is a spread event, the message, door opened, and the element ID of the element, in this case, an instance of the door, that triggered this message. We can then use that element ID to get the instance ID. Here you can see that the instance ID is 100001, which if we come over here, is an instance of the door object. We already know that the message will equal door object. We can see it down here. And we can even check to see which door this is. So again, it is the 001. And look at it. This is actually the blue door. So this will not match. Now, although it might be hard to tell, we've just advanced to the next instance. This is blue door. And I do see now that I've had a space here this whole time. But I'm going to leave it in. It's the same for both objects. We can perform the same steps. And now these two will match. And we'll toggle this instance's visibility. There we go. The person has arrived. And our broadcast message system is working. The broadcast message has several important uses. With sequences, it is an indispensable way of communicating with objects. And it also allows sprites in a room's asset layer to communicate with objects as well. But I find it useful even with sprites attached to instances. It not only gives you an easy way of accessing animation progress, for example, knowing when a sprite has hit frame 3 of 4 or 6 of 10, but its real use is scalability. For example, we could get this same result by adding the following code to the end animation event of our door. With object person, if my door equals other.doorName, visible equals not visible. This would work and do the same thing as our broadcast message system. But now imagine that we have dozens of instances that need to pay attention to this door. We would need dozens of these statements, and our door suddenly contains code for a lot of other objects. And if we want to add an object that interacts with the door opening, we have to add that code here. And remember to remove it should we remove or change that object. This isn't fun and will make larger projects much harder to deal with. The broadcast message allows an object to only care about its own code. The door doesn't need to care if one or 100 objects need to track its message. It just sends the message out. And our person object gets all of its code in its own event. We can add and remove objects at will without messing with our beautifully simple door or making it contain a bunch of code for other objects. At this point, hopefully you're thinking, that seems really nice. I wish I could use the broadcast message with lots of other things. Well, broadcast messages are only for sprites and sequences. But the good news is that the broadcast message system is really just a specific implementation of the publication and subscribe or PubSub pattern, which is very easy to implement in GameMaker. And that video will be coming out, or depending upon when you're watching this, may already be out. But if it isn't, check out these other videos instead.